morning to everyone here again. We say that every single Sunday, good morning, but it is really a great morning as far as I'm concerned. I can't see Chris flying away, but what I can see him is flying away on his motorbike. Scarf and hair going, and he's off to Namibia and Southwest Africa and wherever he was always going. I'll fly away. I'm going to read Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts. My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. I stand amazed to look at God's plan. Every time when I open His Word, I stand absolutely amazed at the plan that God thought out so that you and I one day can fly away with Chris. Most probably, if it was left up to us, we would have devised another plan, a more majestic plan. But God's thoughts are not our thoughts, and His ways are so much higher than our ways. And when you read scripture like this, we realize how small we really are. If left up to man, and we see what the chaotic state that the world is in today, because of man, because man thinks he knows better. There are many people in the world that would have said, but I could have written the Bible better. I could have put in scripture here, which I think would have sounded so much better. I would have put in scripture here, which would have made it easier to be a Christian. And yet when you look at the words that God has put into His Word, into His book, there is no easier way than to fly away to heaven than what He has written. Excuse me. 2 Corinthians 8 and 9 says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sake He became poor, that you through His poverty might become rich. We've got to understand something. Christ had status. Christ was with His heavenly Father. He had it all. He had it all. He didn't have to come down and become poor. But because of this incredible love, which we at times take for granted, the know-alls that will walk outside and say, well, we don't have to go to church. I'm a law unto myself. I look at the nature and I don't walk up in the mountain to find God. You will not find God in the mountain or on the mountain. You will find God where His people are. Because there's this incredible love that God, Jesus Christ Himself also has for us. That is where you find God. He had everlasting divinity, Jesus Christ. He had everlasting divinity. He had equality with God. But the scripture says, yet for your sake, He became poor. The Godhead took a decision that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, would come down to earth. He would be born in a manger, a trough, a place where cattle eat out of. There wasn't a place at the inn. He would be born in this stable. He would be raised with poor parents, take on the job of a carpenter, and He became poor. Why? That through His poverty, we might become rich. You see, because God in His incredible plan, you know, later on we read in the scriptures, Christ came riding on a donkey. Which one of us, if we wanted our son, to make an entrance into George. We'd go and find a donkey. We would go to Edna's farm and find the most beautiful horse that we can find. Maybe a big white black stallion. And we would stand back and we would wait for the sun to come into George coming down York Street. And I would say, my son, God thinks differently. My thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. Because you see, God knows man. Man always seems to know better. Man is a law unto himself, and so we get into the self-pride story and we become arrogant. And this is the difference between Christ and so many of the Christs that are outside there. They think they're a law unto themselves. They don't need God. Well, Christ needs God. Christ has died. And where is he now? Flying up in heaven. You see, Christ had to become like one of us. If Christ had arrived, and I always call this, in a red Ferrari, I wouldn't have been able to identify with him. Because I can't afford a red Ferrari. But I can afford a donkey. And Jesus Christ comes to earth so that we, as the lowly people on earth, can identify with this great Jesus Christ, the greatest man that has ever lived on this earth. And then he goes one step further. He becomes sick. Jesus Christ takes on those sins that every single one of us has here, maybe those sins in the closet. Those sins where, if I think back in my own life, little things that I've done in my life that I might be too embarrassed to even have told my wife. God says, I know those sins. And I have come to take those sins away from you. That's the Christ that we worship today. And I stand amazed at how often myself and others around me, how we take his love and we just throw it into the dustbin as if it really meant nothing. This great man, equality with God, divinity forever, he has his kingdom, he comes down. And he comes to tell me this morning, Danny, Mark, Terry, I've come to take your sins away, that you can fly with me to heaven one day. That's the man we're talking about. That's the greatness of this man. Often we would chat with Chris, and we all know Chris. He was a man that called a spade a spade. But he always had this incredible, almost internal fight with his Lord, because he always felt that he wasn't with heaven. As if he's not good enough for heaven. And Christ says, but you see, that's where I come in. I have come in to make you worthy of heaven. That's why I came down. There's not one of us sitting here this morning. We can go to heaven on our own, not one. And boom, if you think just for a minute that you have that capability, you're being misled seriously. And that is what makes this man, our Savior, our Jesus Christ, makes him who he is. He knew he was going to suffer. You think falling off the horse and breaking your ankle was hurting? Go onto a cross and hang by your arms with nails through your arms and nails through your leg, and you are taking on the sin of the world. And the mother stands, his earthly mother stands next to him, looking at her son. And God stands in heaven looking at his son. That's who we worship. We don't worship Mary, we know that. We worship Jesus Christ was willing to die on that cross for us. He was so different. He was so different. And in all of this, listen to the legacy that he left behind. Philippians 2, 1 to 8, but I'm only going to read verse 8 at this stage. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. And you want to tell me he doesn't love you? With all our faults, and we have many faults. We have many faults. But this love that Christ showed for us, but also the love that he showed for his God, his Father. And he did this because he wanted to leave an example. He wanted to say, Daddy, if you want to go to my Heavenly Father, then this is what I expect of you on earth. Love. Love Marty. Love whoever. Love each other. Don't look for the bad things in each other. Look for the good traits. And that's what Chris did. I'll never forget Chris, but always when he sees Denise and he says something like, oh, you're always such a beautiful person. Something like, something beautiful eyes or something. There is so much love and so much beauty in the world. And Christ came to show us that. The humility that Christ had, it is something that all of us battles with every single day of our lives. It's the humility. Because you see, we're so wanting to be self-seen, self-esteem. We want people to see us for who we are. The carpenter, he walks around with a robe, a pair of sandals. The birds have nests. And the Son of God didn't even have a place to die. They laid him in a tomb. He didn't even have a place. They laid him in somebody else's tomb. And the humility of this man humbles me in a sense of knowing that I have perhaps still so far to go as a man. And then, of course, which we all find so difficult to do, and that's to obey God. We know what the scriptures say to us. We're going to read some of it in a minute. But what worries me sometimes is that I read the scriptures and I think, wow, these are good scriptures. And I walk out the door and I cannot even remember the verse or the scripture that was read that morning. We go to Titus 2, verse 11. It says, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness, worldly desires, to live sensibly, to live righteously, to live godly. Beautiful. What does it mean to live not a life of being ungodly? It means your principles. It means your morals. Those principles that God has put into his word. Adhere to them. Don't just read it and then tomorrow comes along and we say things we shouldn't be saying. We tell jokes that we shouldn't be telling. Can you find one rude joke in the Bible? Can you find one rude joke in the Bible? Can you find anywhere in the Bible except when Christ had to go at the Pharisees because of their hypocrisy, that he used strong language? Did you find anywhere in the Bible where Jesus Christ was a hypocrite? Nowhere. And that is what makes him so different to us. Because, and we're going to read it back in a minute right at the end. The type of life, the type of person that I should try to be to honor him. To honor him. Remember last week, the previous week, the Good Samaritan, the Jesus Christ that helped us, although we weren't even in the church at that time, but somebody came and helped us. And then we said, Lord, how can we honor you? And God says, honor my son. Honor my son. Believe what he says. Do what he says. And so we read what he says. Live sensibly. Live righteously. Live godly. In other words, God is saying to us, excuse me, are you or am I a mature Christian or not? Or am I inclined to be this childish Christian that when things go wrong in our lives, who's the first person we blame? God. And so I stay away from church. God will never, ever move away. He's as solid as the rock that he's built his church on all the time. But man comes along, and because things don't quite go our way, so we point fingers at God and we move away. And he's asking us this morning, how spiritual are we? How mature are we? Can you think of any time that Chris, Andres, Martin, those that have left us this year to go to their father's house, can you ever remember them staying away from church because, for whatever silly reason, they would be here? Why? Because they became mature Christians. And that is what we are talking about over here. If we are, thank you, if we are mature Christians, then we will understand what Christianity is all about. And we will understand God. And we won't look upon this word of God as a myth, as a little fairy tale, something up. You know, it's for kids. It's for children. If we could speak to Chris this morning, and we ask him, Chris, what's it like up there? And he said, oh, you think earth was nice. You ain't seen nothing yet. This is heaven. No more crying. No more pain. I think of the time that Chris took out his knee. He had a knee replacement. And he played around with a bone that was in his knee. That's Chris. He has new knees. He has a new body. All because of Jesus Christ and God. That they have said, on their own, you will not make it. I need to send my son. And so they do. Verse 13, it says, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what we are saying right now. We can't wait. We can't wait to see God. We can't wait to see Jesus. Chris is up there. He's right there. And we hope for that appearance. And now it says, verse 14, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us. Listen carefully to the next few words. It says, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed. It doesn't matter what sin you've committed in your life. It doesn't matter, says Christ. I will wash it clean. I will wash you clean. I just need you to love me. And I need you to believe in me. And I need you to believe in my Father. And I will wash you clean. That's why I came down. It doesn't matter what sin you have in your life. But remember what he said to the prostitute? If they didn't condemn you, then neither do I, but go and sin no more. That's all that he expects of us. He expects of us when we leave this building in this week that is coming, that we take these words with us, that we can remember these words that he said, ooh, I've got to be a mature Christian. I've got to live sin. I've got to live righteously. Let me try. Let me try. So when you young guys get to your friends and they're having one obstacle party and you say, I don't think that's what Christ would have done. You see, what would make Jesus Christ proud of us? What would make him proud? Take your life. What would make him proud is when you stand up for him. That'll make him proud. It says, to redeem us from every lawless deed, purify for himself a people for his own possession. Zealous for good deeds. I have a question, and we're going to read about it now. I have this question. He says, to redeem us from every lawless deed that we've ever committed. Because he, at the Lord's table, we know, he will purify us. For himself, a people for his own possession. Are we, as we are sitting here right now, can I say, Lord, I'm one of yours. I'm one of yours. Or would we be hesitant? Would we be hesitant to say, Lord, I think? Or would I know I'm one of his? 1 Peter 2:9-10. And we know these words, and I love this scripture. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. Am I one of them? We've got two different scriptures here. Am I? Is Chris? Where is Chris right now? Is he with his father? Look at his life. You never missed a service. He did the way the things are supposed to be done. Martin, Andres, us. Why? Because God loved us. And he loves us. And you're sitting here right now. He has this incredible love for you. And he says, honor my son. Honor my son. And listen to him. And that is why we are here this morning. Because God has, there are two places to go. We all have to die, unfortunately. Some of us would like to live for 150 years. I don't know, I don't want to. But we have to die. And it's either going to be in God's chosen race, or it'll be Satan's chosen race. That's our choice. The magnificence of God is he doesn't take his finger or bottle or whatever and hit you over the head and say, hey, you've got to come to me. He leaves it up to us. The greatest decision that we could ever make in this world, he leaves up to us. The great God that can squash the world just like that. He says, it's your choice. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what kind of life you've lived. I sent my son to take that away from you. And you are now pure. You are now mine. But then you must follow my son. You must follow my son. That you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For you were once not a people, that means you were nothing. Nothing. You didn't belong. I didn't belong to anybody. And God says, I'm going to send my son that you can belong to me, that Chris can belong to me. Now, you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. In other words, Jesus says, I know you and I know your life. I know exactly what you're doing. I've asked you to become my people for good deeds. But I also know there's certain parts in your life which is not how it should be. And I have come to point those things out to you. Stop doing what you're doing. I want you as part of my possession, my chosen people. let's go to heaven. But it's our choice. It's our choice. I ask again, what choice did Chris make? Where is he? I'll fly away up to heaven. And so I mentioned this in our Bible study on Tuesday. Of the greatest scriptures in the world comes down. If we go to Philippians chapter 2, I'm going to read the first 5 verses. It's on the board. Listen to the words. If therefore there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, in others, Christ is basically saying this. If you love me, if you say you love me, then listen up, he says. Make my joy complete, for by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing. Do nothing from unselfishness or empty conceit. But with humility of mind, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. That's a piece of cake. That's a piece of cake. How many of us would have done what Jesus did? That he would go and hang on the cross. He's just come from heaven. He had it all. And he came down like a common thief, a common murderer. That's what they looked at him, hanging on the cross. For you know that we can fly away one day with him to heaven. Let each of you regard one another as more important than yourself. For do not merely look out for your own personal interest, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourself, which was also in Christ Jesus. Christ says to us this morning, if you love me, then have that attitude. But if you stand before me one day, and I point you to the other way, it's because we didn't have humility in our lives. It's because we didn't have the ability or almost the love for Christ to put others before us. It's most probably the most difficult thing in the world is to play second fiddle, because we all like to play first fiddle. We want to be the main one. You know, and if I look at Chris, I look at Andres, and I look at Martin. It's been a tough year. It's been a tough year. But if I look at the caliber of men that are sitting around God's throne today, then I also want to be one of them. And I cannot wait to fly away to my Heavenly Father. But oh boy, I've just got to make sure of one thing, that when I stand there before the Heavenly Father and my advocate Jesus Christ stands next to him, next to me, he stands there with a smile and with his arms open and say, I will fight for you. That's it. It's our choice. Let us stand and sing.